So, JP, how long have you known that you were vegan?
Well, I think part of me is still in denial about that. So, yet to be discovered, I think.
That actually brings you to my next question. How long, or when did you know you were ultra-spiritual?
Well, that's a good question. As soon as I had a realization that I am better than everybody else, it led me to this spiritual realization that I am ultra-spiritual.
All right, so as you're digesting that, we want to introduce who we have here. In case you don't know him, which I would be amazed if you didn't, his name is JP Sears. We've known you for about a year and a half now, after Daniel did the first interview with you. And I will introduce you from my perspective. JP is one of my best friends. He is one of the, let's just say that if I am desperate for advice, he is one of the first people that I'm going to come to. I value what you have to say almost more so than anybody here on this earth. Actually, I'm sitting by the two people, what an honor, I'm sitting by the two people whose opinion I value so very much. And you also are, what would you say, owner or whatever of innerawakeningsonline.com,
mm-hmm.
where you do emotional healing. You host retreats and seminars around the world. JP is an awesome dude. And he has red hair.
I like myself better after that introduction. Thank you, my friend. That feels really good to hear.
And I think the only reason to add on to that is you wouldn't know JP is because people are, they get a little insecure in the shadow of JP's greatness and wisdom, such as myself. I'll be the first to admit it, because I'm apparently addicted to being uncomfortable. So one more question before we begin. When did you know you were enlightened?
That's a good question. For me, the enlightened person is the one enlightened enough to know where they are unenlightened. So based on what I'm aware of about myself, I think I'm more aware of how unenlightened I am. And paradoxically, does that shine the light on my enlightenment? I don't know. I'm not enlightened in the fullest sense of the term by any stretch of the imagination, but it's a fun question to dance with. Thank you.
Yeah, if you don't know, if you haven't picked up on the little humor, or as Brandon Hawk would say, sarcasm maybe, JP recently became much more well-known online through his parodies on how to become ultra-spiritual, was it how to become a vegetarian, how to be an awesome parent. Are those the right titles?
Yeah, there's a video, well, I guess there's an episode scheme that I have ongoing on the ultra-spiritual theme that was kind of birthed from the first video called How to Be Ultra-Spiritual that went viral, so there's continuing episodes of the ultra-spiritual life.
So
different topics.
Yeah, definitely check those videos out, and it'll take you about 10 seconds to realize that everything he said is geniusly funny. Now, why, and I was talking to this on a more serious note, I was talking to JP about this, why am I so affected by parodies? Why do you think people, what is it? What is it about a parody?
Well,
good question.
Yeah, a parody being certainly an expression of humor. I think humor is a powerful way to open a gateway to intimacy, and I think what you say, well, why intimacy? I think inside of us is a lot of consciousness, a lot of our inner enlightenment, in fact, perhaps all of our inner enlightenment is found when we become more intimate with ourselves. So I think humor, some of the time, is a very effective key to open ourselves to possibilities we wouldn't otherwise consider. So I would guess with you, Daniel, if I sat here and said, Daniel, here's the truth of the matter, you know, people lose themselves on the path that they're trying to find themselves on. Yeah, when I'm telling you, you know, that's the truth,
mm-hmm.
How are you going to feel?
Yeah, knowing myself, I might get a little, I want to puff up against that, get a little defensive, maybe prove you wrong. When someone states something as fact, I think there's a part of me that wants to be like very questioning and challenging to that.
Yeah. And I would agree, and that's how my defended ego gets, defended, if that's not redundant, I don't know what is. So anyway, when we can take the levity of life through humor, it perhaps allows us to consider something that our hard-shell defended ego would otherwise be blocking out. It's kind of like my dog, for example. If I've got to give him medicine, I want to package it in a way that he's going to swallow it. So I'm going to give him the medicinal pill wrapped around meat. If I just give him a pill, he's going to defend against that. He's not going to swallow it. He'll spit it out, and he's done it plenty of times. But when we use the meat of humor to be the carrier for a deeper message, to me, it's actually proven to be a very effective way to invite people to new realizations.
That being said, for the vegetarians that just got offended that you said meat is funny,
mm-hmm.
what would you have to say to them?
Well, I'd invite you to check out episode 3 of Altered Spiritual Life called How to Become a Vegetarian, which literally it looks like vegetarians are being made fun of, and actually that's not my intention at all, even though that is the literal realm that I'm dancing in. So I would invite you to actually check that video out, and please get offended if you need to be offended, and feel those emotions, and you feel those offended emotions that your heart generates. I don't think anybody else's heart is going to generate emotions that you feel. And I'm saying this in a way where you're probably getting defended about my words right now. But anyway, feel your emotions about that. And my challenge for you along with just that is to look for the deeper message that actually has nothing to do with vegetarianism mm-hmm. that I believe is in that video.
Yeah, humor is so essential to my life, and a lot of times I apply humor to insecurities that I have, or something that seems very real to me at the time, because what I learned over, last few years is that some of the things that seem like the biggest crisis of my day today are usually something I can end up laughing and joking about later. Or, you know, as that saying that you like to say,
I like to say that saying,
the crisis of today is the joke of tomorrow. Someone else said that, and I just quote their quote without giving them credit for it sometimes.
Maybe I could quote Timothy, who's quoting you, who was quoting someone else.
Hmm. I just think that when we take our challenges so seriously that we can't laugh about, well, that's when you know you have a real challenge on your hands. I've also heard, I think, crisis over time equals comedy.
Hmm. I like that. Yeah, if you...
experience crisis anyways. At least if you're willing to feel it. If you're willing to feel the feelings that come along with it. I think as long as we keep denying the pain denials where real suffering takes place, just asterisks.
I would agree. I think if there could only be one medicine on planet Earth, out of all the plants and even out of all the man-made pharmaceuticals out there, I would say the one medicine that probably will do more universal good for humanity than any other would probably be the medicine of laughter.
Wow.
Preferably laughing at yourself without shaming yourself. Mm-hmm. Laughing in a way at yourself where you're actually accepting yourself to a new level, rather than shaming yourself and rather than laughing at someone else in a shaming, rejecting way. And as I actually kind of said in passing a few minutes ago, how a possible truth that you can consider is the path you take to find yourself can also become the path that you begin to lose yourself on. So if we're talking about laughter as wonderful medicine, well, when does the medicine of laughter actually become a poison? So I like to be aware of the shadow of anything going on to the best of my ability. So I would invite you to also consider the shadow side of laughter could actually be to mask pain, not heal pain, but mask pain. And I think there's a really awesome archetypal example of how laughter and humor is used to mask pain, and that would be the Joker from the Batman movie, specifically the Joker played by Heath Ledger. I mean, his smile is actually built from scars.
Hmm.
And what does that symbolically represent about you and I? How is that Joker a potential reflection of how we might fall in the trap of you using laughter for the shadow side?
Yeah, that's a great question. It leads me to my next question. Do you even think deeply?
That's a good question, and here's a thought on that. Whatever level of depth of thinking you think you get to, I would dare say, I think Eckhart Tolle says something like creative thought, deep thought, comes not through knowing how to think, but through knowing how not to think.
Oh, wow.
I think our thinking mind is incredibly limited. And I think when we can learn how to go into thought, understand thought, and function at that level, you know, rather than a dog who's a little bit more of an emotional, reactive, and responsive being, we kind of mature ourselves into the thinking realm, and then we go beyond it. We learn how to stop our thinking mind so that we can mature beyond that. At times, I mean, in any given moment, do I need my thinking mind, or do I want to think deeply in a way that's actually deeper than the thinking mind can think? Which might be, some would say that means we're connected to God, our higher self, artistic creativity, Mother Nature, the universe, just kind of whatever terminology you want to put on it.
Well, speaking of juggling from the shadow side to the light side, you were alluding to Dr. Patch Adams, by laughter being the medicine, and it's not the doctor that, or is that just a movie that I watched? Well, it was a movie that I watched, and the main actor actually was Robin Williams, the doctor. And Robin Williams definitely made some headlines recently when he, if I understand correctly, he decided to take his own life. Has that been confirmed?
I think that's true.
I think that's true. Regardless if that's true or not, what is suicide to you? What does that mean to you? That's a good question.
Yeah, well, if that's not a abrupt question, what would be?
Yeah.
Well, here's my take on suicide. It is a person who feels incredibly out of control, and in order to escape their terror of feeling like they have no control over their life, they embark upon the ultimate control drama, the ultimate, I have control of my life, and here it is, through suicide. It is the, from my point of view, it's our ego's expression of declaring, I have control, and watch this. No one can stop me, not even you, God, is I think what our needy, fearful egos who feel out of control and would rather experience a sense of control than live.
That's a pretty great explanation, I think. And that kind of reminds me, if you are watching this video and have ever had thoughts of suicide, or you are at a very unhappy place with your life, I really want to encourage you to reach out to someone, to just even message us and let us know that, but don't keep it to yourself. And that's, I'm talking to you, if that's something that you've been struggling with.
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, our levity of humor in this video aside, suicidal thoughts, and even more intensely, suicidal tendencies, it's very common, yeah. And the best thing you can do for yourself is reach out to someone who cares, and potentially to a very qualified medical professional.
Yeah, and you know, I think that the RawBrahs, I know for myself, I live a lifestyle that is, from your perspective, amazing. It's like I wake up every day and I ask myself, what do I want to do, and I do just that. And it's, I too have a lot of struggles with life. There's a lot of times where I feel depressed, down, and I just want to share that with you. That maybe you think that we live exclusively of challenges or even depression, but I can say that's not true for me.
Yeah.
Would I be out of line to assume, for at least for yourself, and I'm kind of assuming for myself, I'm making this assumption on myself, and maybe you too, JP, that one of the healthiest things that you guys have ever done is to express the things that you don't want to express. The part of you, the mind part, the part that wants to stay in control, the part that wants to control what other people think of you. That has that been maybe where, Timothy, you have been able to tap into this, doing what you want, that you've been feeling the energy and motion flow through you more freely, where you weren't paralyzed by it, but you felt free from it?
Yeah, Daniel, that's right on. I have found so much liberty or freedom from expressing the things that I feel most embarrassed about, the most shameful about. I can't speak any higher about doing just that. Which actually, since we're talking about that, I wanted to ask you, JP, and you too, Daniel, that oftentimes when we're doing videos, especially when I'm doing videos with you, Daniel, I feel insecure. I feel that, like right now, that you care more about what Daniel thinks than I think. And I want to acknowledge that right here on camera. It's a reoccurring thing that I dealt with, and I feel... I just want to know, what do you think about me expressing that?
Yeah, that's one of the things I love about Timothy. That's one of the things I love about you, Timothy. From my perspective, you lead your life from your heart. Not when, and you're a human being, from my perspective, sometimes you hide your heart just like everybody else. But when you share with me, you know, JP, right now I feel insecure, scared. It seems like you're more interested in Daniel, and you know what, I feel sad about that. When you say things like that to me, it's like you're bringing me your heart. And that to me is where, it's one of the reasons why I think Timothy and I have such a close friendship. Where Timothy doesn't just tell me the things he's comfortable with. If he did, that means everything else in his heart, and he's a human being, so that means a lot more in his heart, is going to be concealed. It won't be revealed to me. So Timothy might give me 5% of his heart. You know, I'm cool and I'm secure. Okay. And the other 95% of me is in the closet. So... yeah, it actually makes, that's my long way of saying, I feel closer to you when you share with me your insecurities, your concerns. And actually, come to think of it, these guys have been staying at my house here for a few days, and something throughout the whole day today that I haven't said to you guys that I think I've been scared to say, that it feels like a burden not saying it, is, you know, I've been a little bit stressed today. I've worked with some clients and kind of a busy day. I'm teaching a live video seminar that I do for some of my subscribers. I'm doing that later tonight. I've got some notes I want to prepare for that, and, you know, feeling kind of stressed, and I think I've been feeling stressed because I haven't been able to look at Daniel, Timothy, and my girlfriend Deanna, and Diana, the people around me. I haven't been able to say, you know what, guys? I feel scared right now that I'm going to go on the video seminar tonight, and I won't be good enough. I'm scared that people won't think I'm doing a perfect job at that. And... part of me's actually been too insecure to share that with you guys, because I rationalize lies being the key part of that word. I rationalize, well, I've been doing that sort of thing, teaching those classes for years. I shouldn't still get scared about that. What are people going to think of me? But you know what the truth is? I get pretty scared about that. A lot of times I act like I don't, and that seems to actually burden me more than when I can open my heart and say, you know, I feel like a scared little boy right now.
What about me?
Well, let me ask you something. Is that because
go ahead, Timmy.
Is that because you're racist towards white people?
You know, my grandfather...
that's why I like it. That's why. I actually had something sort of to say.
You know, my grandfather once taught me a great insight. When I was a little boy, he would sit me on his knee, And you'd say, JP, there's two things you need to know about life. First is negative comments on YouTube about you are always accurate. Number two, don't trust white people. So, to answer your question, in the spirit of my grandfather, yes.
I thought so. Yeah, definitely want to honor these guys for expressing what they're insecure about. And I mean, how important is that? I mean, just a few guys, you know, it just so happens, I guess, that we are inclined for edutainment value that I think we try, when we turn the camera on, we really want to convey the spirit of inspiration and encouragement and give a good message while doing it. But don't let that fool you. A lot of times when the camera's off, there's a lot of discomfort, which I still think, I'm really still working on the perspective that you can still make that fun comfortable. But there's a lot of things that are not, that would not be that pretty for a camera.
Yeah.
A lot. And I think the more that we allow ourselves to experience that, the more that we can be ourselves during this.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
The more we can let the light shine through, the more, you know, to the degree, there's all kinds of little metaphors we could come up with, to the degree that we allow ourselves to feel the rain, is to the degree that we might allow ourselves to feel the sun, to the degree we allow ourselves to feel pain, might be to the degree that we allow ourselves to feel bliss. And that sometimes this avoidance of the pain is so much more painful than just experiencing it.
Yeah,
I'm going to say something, probably...
Don't preach me down when I'm preaching good!
Sorry, I messed
don't
up.
Shoot me down
I'm gonna come
when
back
I'm
at
preaching
you.
Good.
I was just going to say, I'm probably going to say one of the most wise things that you've ever heard anyone ever say on YouTube before. And that is, what you believe people love you for may not actually be what they love you at all for. And the things that you think would ruin your relationship with people if you told them may be the exact thing that might connect you the most if you shared it with them.
Yeah. I've got on my desk over there a little note I wrote to myself a couple years ago. It's still on my desk because I still need to read it. It says, it's okay for me to be JP, nothing more. Mm. And that... I don't know what that means to you. Whatever your name is, I'd ask you to say that out loud right now. It's okay for me to be me,
JP.
Nothing more.
It's okay for me to be JP, right?
It's okay
Absolutely.
For me to be a jolly pumpkin.
And I don't know what kind of chord on the harp of your heart that strikes. And I'd ask you to feel it. And kind of what that does for me is part of JP, parts... of JP are sad, some are angry, some are shameful, some feel afraid, some feel joy, some feel excitement, some are very creative. And what you mentioned, Daniel, essentially, if I won't let myself experience the shadow side of me, those things I don't like, those things I'm not aware of, if I don't let myself experience that, then to the degree I limit myself, there is, in my experience, the degree I limit myself from expressing my gifts, my light, my joy. So that's one of the reasons why I think we're talking about descending into our shadows, our uncomfortable aspects, our painful emotions, when we feel out of control in life, to be able to actually acknowledge that, and then in appropriate situations with friends and loved ones and people who you feel safe with, share it with them. Very liberating. I would dare say it allows you more fully to be the miracle of your own self rather than concealing the miracle of your own self. To me, that's the biggest injustice you can ever do on your world and the world around you, which is hiding the miracle that you are.
Mm. Now, that was deep, JP. You quoted Daniel just now from something that he said earlier in this interview. Now, can you quote me? Because I want to feel important too.
Yeah, a wise man named Timothy once said, JP is a great guy. He is just one of the most insightful, gorgeous redheads. And I'm paraphrasing here. One of the most gorgeous human beings with striking blue eyes that I've ever met. that get you right?
Yeah, I need to feel important, and you did just that for me, JP.
It's important to feel important.
And that's actually what I was doing earlier when I said, what about me? And then you brought it up, was that I wanted to, how important is it for us to feel important, guys? How important is that?
Wow.
You know, I was actually wondering, here I am, we were talking about being ourselves, and my body heat is going way up.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, I'm just going to unbutton the shirt.
Wow.
I had to, because I was like, well, they might, because I have a good body, y'all might think I'm conceited and I'm showing it off. In reality, I'm just freaking hot.
But what if
my body temperature went up to make myself feel important, because it was that important for me to feel important?
Mm, that's deep.
Whoa.
That's deep, Daniel.
How important? Come on, someone tell me how important.
What if you were overweight, man, right? And you decided that you were so hot you want to unbutton your shirt, right?
Uh-huh.
And you did. People might think, wow, he is so self-confident. But oftentimes, just because Daniel has a great body, and I do too. I mean, my body's probably actually better than his. I'm just not going to show you. That we're going to think, what a conceited a-hole he is to take his shirt off in the middle of an interview. So this is just going to show you that we often don't honor people who we think don't need honoring.
Mm-hmm.
But we all need honoring. We all need to feel important, including someone as great as Daniel, including someone as great as JP.
Including someone as great as you. And you don't want to fall into that trap of sympathetic giving, because from what I found is it kind of gives into this, feel sorry for me. It almost
mm-hmm.
feeds into that, instead of, look how great I am.
Yeah.
Does that ring true to you?
Yes.
Yeah. So let's talk about this. How important is it to feel important, JP?
So. Yeah, you know, I'm not a medical doctor, so don't take this the wrong way. It's not medical advice. It's not scientific fact. Yet, darn near 100% of the people who I've ever met are actually human beings. And part of the human condition is neediness, the need to feel important. It's part of the human condition. It's part of our codependent nature. And I think a lot of times we think, oh my gosh, it's horrible to feel needy. I'm not needy. Maybe what that actually says is, I'm so needy that I have the need to not be needy. So I'm going to conceal my neediness, my humanness, my need to feel important. Nope, I'm going to pretend that's not there. I won't give myself permission to actually be a human being. I'll have to be a human being without giving myself permission to be a human being. And that is a life of tension, conflict,
turmoil.
Where we, turmoil, are in constant struggle against our human nature. And in fact, I would dare say it's so important to feel important that even our inner parts that don't feel important, I have parts of me that feel unimportant that we've talked about earlier, insecure. It's important, or our unimportant parts are important enough that it's important to pay attention to them.
Bing, 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 bing. I'm hitting my I need to feel important button.
This is important, because actually, but that reminds me of something that happens. This happens on retreats. Oh, we'll talk about her. No, but really, what happens in our retreats is that, and it's kind of funny. Sometimes it seems kind of funny, but it almost turns into a circle. Like, I'm jealous. Like, I'm feeling ashamed right now. Or, like, I feel like I don't like what you just said. And it's just, like, it's almost like a button.
Yeah.
And what I would, what Timothy's doing, that bing, 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 is, like, as silly as it seems, if you can co-create that context, it's one, in my opinion, it's one of the healthiest environments I've ever been in. When people can talk about their shame, like people typically talk about the weather. Or if we can talk about what we're embarrassed to say, or the thing that we want to talk, say the least, like people talk about the Braves. Or wherever your sports team of the day is, whatever distraction of the day is. But don't neglect your 1 second of courage to share yourself,
mm-hmm.
as scary as that sounds.
Mm-hmm.
Man, if anything, for me, that would be one of the most important things of this whole video or podcast, is that you start, it's a daily practice. It's not something you do once. And we talked about this in a previous video somewhere, but some people, I think, get the idea, especially, you know, not physically. So, like, imagine if you were trying to run a 4-minute mile, JP.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that...
I have run a 4-minute mile before.
Do you think... Can you imagine, like, yesterday you ran, like, 10 miles, and you're like, all right, well, I guess I'll work out again 3 years from now.
Yeah.
But are you going to get your 4-minute mile?
No.
I think that's pretty obvious. But it takes relentless daily practice, and then maybe the days you're not practicing to rest. You have to be conscious about resting.
That's an amazing point, this daily practice of courage. I call it courage because let's just say, like, when I have a thought, like, I'm feeling insecure or I'm feeling not important. So, yeah, it takes a lot of courage to tell Daniel in the moment that, hey, I'm feeling jealous of you. Hey, JP, can you show me a little more attention? Or, like, and it's not that he is to show me more attention. This is not the goal of this expression. The goal is just to release myself of that bent-up energy inside of me. I mean, it works.
To share you, who you are. To
and you know who, if you need some inspiration from this, watch babies or animals.
Mm. Yes.
I mean, I've been with some babies. Those babies, when they're like, I'm not getting enough attention, they're like, yeah. And I was like, man,
look what happens to an animal. You cry, the animal comes.
Yeah, man, you guys just don't, if you can't convey what you're trying to say, just cry.
He's
yeah.
like, I understand what that means. I do that when I'm hungry.
And if what I would consider, we're going to bring Zephyr in here, he's obviously needy enough, he needs your attention. You know? What I would consider to be pretty essential to consider with what we're talking about is when you need, if you choose to give yourself the gift of expressing what's in your heart, I would invite you to do it with people who aren't going to shame you, they're not going to belittle you. So if you're sharing your deepest shame, the last thing I would want you to do is to share it with someone who's going to shame you for sharing your shame. Sometimes that's going to happen, but when you're creating your safe space, you know, Daniel, Timothy, they're part of my safe space. My girlfriend's part of my safe space, but I'm not going to go up to a stranger on the street who looks disgruntled and say, you know what, here's my greatest shame. You could do that. However, if you're hurt and wounded, the last thing you want to do is expose yourself and get hurt and wounded to a greater degree. It's kind of like children. You know, a child can, you know, play their heart out at the playground. It's a safe space for it. But a child, you put them in the middle of an intersection in downtown Manhattan, that's not a safe space for the child to be playing their heart out. So to me, that's just sort of a helpful note so that we can find, so we can create a place that's safe to be to feel unsafe.
It reminds me of what you taught us about what it takes to be a good dad, and that was when your kid cries, you tell him, wipe it up, son, there's no crying in this family.
Absolutely. You can check out my video, How to Be a Powerful Parent.
Yeah, and
parody. That was a parody.
Also, JP is talking about creating this context. Well, this is kind of what we do at our retreats. We create this context with a group of people who are willing to go there with us. You know how people say we're not going to go there? Well, we go there with everyone with that agreement. Our next retreat is coming up January 2nd, Virgin Islands. We still have, I think, a spot or two left for that. Throw that out there.
Zephyr wanted to come on that. Is he?
Yeah, he's allowed to come. Now I have a question for you, Jake Peasnut.
That was an awkward silence followed by an awkward statement. I love.
Let's say you're in a relationship. Man, woman, I guess it'd be man and man too, or woman on woman. But one of the people in the relationship is thinking that this isn't going to work out for them, and they're not feeling the same way about the person they originally did, and considering breaking up. Mm-hmm. What would you say the repercussions of sharing that with their partner would be as soon as it came up for them?
Well, that's a good question. To me, it would be a powerful sharing, and all power has a constructive or destructive possibility. So, in other words, I believe what I'm hearing you say is, let's just say in my relationship, I have an, all of a sudden a sense of, I think I want to leave this relationship, and just share that right off the bat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if I was giving a one-size-fits-all opinion, before I just share it right off the bat, what I would want to consider is, what is it about myself I'm wanting to leave? You know, the literal experience is, I have this urge to leave the relationship. And if I tell my partner that, which you definitely want to tell your partner, it's just like, do you want to introspect first? And introspection works well for me. So I would want to consider, okay, it appears as though I want to leave her, yet what is it about me? What feelings in me, what experiences am I having that I want to leave? So before I go to my partner, I want to get clear on what's inside of me that I'm wanting to escape from. And if I can't find clarity, then I want to share that with my partner too. So, you know what, I have urges to leave this relationship, and you know what, there's a message about me in there. I'm not sure what it is, or if I am sure, here's what it is. Yet that opens up pretty scary, pretty vulnerable territory. But if you don't, my opinion, sooner rather than later, share what's really going on inside, then for me, the relationship becomes a place of suffocation to the degree that we're not expressing through our airwaves what's going on in our heart.
Let's talk about this for a second, this context creation, unless you had something...
Yeah, I do. I just want to really focus in on that last part of what you said, because I really believe this to be true, that if you do not express what's going on for you, or what's real for you, that it creates a thing of suffocation, you said. And it's very likely, from what I'm hearing, that the relationship is going to come to an end regardless if you keep that with inside of you.
I absolutely. My opinion is if you keep it inside of you, the relationship will end before you think it does. Mm-hmm. In other words, the intimacy is killed. Me communicating is communion, it's togetherness, oneness. Mm-hmm. That's out the window. So the relationship is over. It just so happens to be those two people are still in close physical proximity, just with no relationship.
So I see a big theme here that might need to be, in my opinion, stressed a little bit, and that's creating the context. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the best contexts I've ever seen is a RawBrahs retreat, to share your shame, a JP workshop, also doing retreats now. But for people that are not attending these functions, and I wanted to share that, like, say, let's just pretend that I was thinking that I wanted to, let's actually make it more hypothetical, like, leave your girlfriend. You want to leave your girlfriend or something.
I want to leave Timothy's girlfriend.
You want to leave Timothy's girlfriend. So, do you think...
Do you have a girlfriend?
I won't share who that is.
Okay.
So if you're going to share it to her, then do you think you're just supposed to be like, hey, guys, I'm going to tell you real quick before I go out the door for some coffee. I think I'm gonna leave yours and Timothy's relationship. Please. I know obviously that's the wrong. That's probably the one end of the spectrum. So instead of even telling people how to do it, I want us to all practice how we were gonna share that.
Wow.
Okay?
Okay.
So I'll go. Like, hey, Timothy's girlfriend, my name is JP. I've been watching lots of RawBrahs videos of these guys that talk about sharing everything and the health that comes from that, and they do these retreats, and they recommend this book called Radical Honesty, and they talk about all these ideas that they think you can tap into your highest level of health by sharing all the things you don't want to share. And I have some things, when I heard that, some things came up in me that I was like, I'm not even sure if these thoughts, I was just thinking them because they sound scared to share, or if there are actually some authenticity to them. So if you're willing to check out some of the similar videos, or if read that book, or if you just want to do it and guarantee that we won't get violent, guarantee that we won't leave, guarantee we'll stick with each other, and I'll give you time to share after I share, would you be willing to maybe experiment with that when we have time? That's how I would do it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know, how important do you think it is to ask questions before making big shares like that?
Yeah, well, obviously you want to attend 3 or 4 RawBrahs retreats before you have any important conversation. I love your guys' retreats. I've been a part of at least 3. Yeah, well, if I wanted to leave Timothy's girlfriend, or, you know, certainly initiating the conversation where you're going to be actually present for the conversation rather than I'm out the door for coffee. So I might say to this other person, hey, I've got some things in my heart I need to share. do you have free time for us to talk now? And if not, when do you have an hour or a couple hours where we can sit down and be present with each other? Preferably where we agree not to leave the conversation running out, but stay with it. Not necessarily until we find all of our answers. There may not be answers, but until we are feeling complete with what we each need to share in the moment. That to me, mentioned earlier, it helps create a safe environment to share things that don't feel safe to us. That's why we tend to inherently conceal them. It takes a lot of practice and courage to wear our insides on the outside.
And I really want to, I want Timothy to go too, just to give another twist on it, because I'm starting to wonder, like, what's more important, the sharing or the context, or maybe they're equally as important. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you for the invitation, Daniel. This is how I would share or invite someone is, hey, you know, I've never, some of my best relationships that I have are the ones where I'm most free to express both my appreciations and resentments with my friend or my brother. And I want the same thing with you. I've never had a relationship where I don't have any resentments. And are you willing for me to share my resentments with you and yours with mine? And at that point, I think it's, how could you not say no to that? Would you ever tell your person, your friend, your loved one, whatever, no, I'd rather not hear your resentments about me? Well, I'm assuming that your person will respond the same way.
But can you imagine the contrast of that invitation, one of those three invitations, versus, man, I've been thinking about breaking up with you, I gotta go.
Yeah.
Like, what in the world? And that, so I just want to make sure this message is not getting misconstrued, that the context is so crucial.
Or more, Daniel, I think a more common way that people would just blow up and leave would be like things just bubble up, and they're like, I hate it when you do this, and they're like, I'm out of here. You know, they express resentment, and then they leave, and you're just like, that is not good.
You know, that, to me, Timothy, I think you touch on the defense strategy that untold amounts of people use. I've used it, where instead of actually sharing the vulnerabilities of our heart, we create a story, we write a story, read the story, then believe the story. We've written a story about why we're so upset and angry so that we can just get angry passively or aggressively and leave the situation rather than actually being vulnerable. So that I consider anger to be a very healthy emotion, a very powerful emotion, but that instance, to me, that's using the power of anger very destructively. I'm going to use anger to build a hard, concealed shell around my heart. You're screwed up. I'm out of here.
Yeah.
I'm glad we don't have to talk about what's in my heart now.
Yeah, and that's, man, for me personally, what I found by doing these invitations and sticking through it and sharing things that I don't want to share is that I've come to learn to not always trust my thoughts, actually. I've come to a place where I don't even believe my own thoughts sometimes, but I have tapped into something that I would say is much more important, which is a divine wisdom in the form of intuition. Mm-hmm. And I've learned to lean more on that than rather random fleeting thoughts when I'm angry or maybe sleepy or some kind of other influence that's just a fleeting influence that doesn't really tell the whole picture of my heart. Mm-hmm. And this is, once again, a daily practice.
Now, JP, I wanna ask you, are you willing to do a live experiment right now about some resentments that you may have not shared with us while we've been staying at your house?
I'm ready, brother.
Guys, we have live resentments coming in at $9.99 out of your home shopping network. Call 1-800-JOLLY-PUMPKIN.
Deanna, can you hand me that knife?
And we have not done this yet, so this is, you're seeing it for the first time here. JP, go for it.
Thank you for the invitation to share what's on my heart. In fact, I didn't even know I have resentments on my heart until you invited me to go there, and wow, they come up. So Right now I'm looking at who's gonna come. My office wall where marks are on the wall where Daniel was rubbing the chair against the wall while he was interviewing Teal Swan. There's a part of me looks at that, and kind of what that represents to me is, this is a story my mind makes up about what that represents to me, which is Daniel's not respecting my stuff. I'm looking at a wall, but what I'm really seeing is countless hours of work that have been necessary to buy my home. So it actually, what part of me sees is Daniel was stepping all over my work, my energy that went into that. And, so that's part of me that has some resentment about that. And I'm not going to really deflect from the resentment by looking at, well, what's that say about me? I'm not going to go there. I'm just going to, part of me projects some resentment towards you about that.
Well, let's pretend that he was resenting me and how maybe I would react, what I think would be the proper way to react. And speaking, you talked about Teal Swan, so I'll borrow her. I created a little acronym around something that she said at a recent workshop I went to, which was RUVA, recognizing, understanding, validating, allowing, and then offering a perspective. So I recognize, JP, that you were maybe experiencing some anger and resentment towards me.
Mm-hmm.
And I could understand that because this is what you said, actually, because you bought this house, and maybe if I wasn't caught up in my own world, that I would have been more aware that I was actually rubbing some paint off your wall. So I definitely understand how you would be resentful. And this is a little rushed, but I think it's so valid. That's so valid. Mm-hmm. If this was my house, I might even resent you more than you resent me.
Yeah. That... RUVA. Say that again.
So I'm almost there. Recognize the emotion, understand it, validate it, no matter what, validate it, allow it, and then this is when that's when you offer the perspective after all those are done. So many people want to jump to that first step to give advice. It's like, hey, you know what worked for you? Have you got your foot out of your butt? And that's all they say rather than going through the RUVA first. So I just was validating him. And now I want to allow you to feel. Are you still feeling angry a little bit, or do you? Because I think you should.
Yeah. I don't feel anger in this moment. There might be a little more there under the surface still. Maybe not yet. I don't feel it. In fact, that acknowledgement, like I feel heard by you. I feel like Daniel has heard me. And to me, actually, that matters more. Like, if I said, oh, rub the paint off the wall, if you, like, hopped up, got a paint can, repainted it, or said, well, let me wash it off, and even if you fixed it completely, not that it's that screwed up, but it would actually matter more to me that you heard me than to have the wall look perfect.
So I'm going to continue allowing this. It sounds like, JP, it sounds like you may be feeling better about the situation, but I think it's so valid that you would be angry about that. If something else comes up later, I still invite you to tell me about it. Because I'm not sure, if I were you, I'm not sure if I would be over it yet that quickly. You might be able to bounce back from things quicker than I can. So that's awesome if that's true, and if not, make sure to share it with me later.
Yeah, I respect that. I will if anything comes up.
And ding, 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 RUVA is done. So now I could offer a perspective that JP might be able to listen to. And my perspective would be that, I guess what happened was I got so excited that all of us were talking to Teal at one time. It was like so crowded back there. And I think I was nervous. And I thought I was rubbing it, so what happened, I kept looking back and not seeing marks, but now looking back on it, the bottom, like the lower part of the chair, and I thought, and it actually did leave a mark. And I think my best perspective or advice would be that I would be happy to find a way to fix that. If you have anything that, like the touch-up paint, maybe I can do that later, if you'd like. Or actually, I might obligate you to let me do it.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if a little bit of a wet washcloth Because that might not be paint rubbed off. It might just be kind of a coloration from the chair.
Now, that was authentic communication. Here's the other side of the coin. Your wall's cheap.
Mm, you're a cheap human being.
Yeah, that's it.
It's very...
So that was a loser, I think, but I would recommend the first one.
So, you know, JP, thank you for sharing that resentment with Daniel. And it's very important that, again, Daniel doesn't skip right to the perspective part where JP shares his resentment. And then Daniel's like, you know, I was just really excited that we were talking, we did the interview and we were all crammed back there. No, you have to really let JP share his resentment. And
that was a minor issue. Some people do this on major things.
Yeah, that's what I was actually going to say is, yeah, it may seem like a minor issue, and it is. But if you continuously allow these things to happen without expressing your resentments to Daniel, maybe in a week from now, Daniel's going to be in your kitchen. He's going to, like, spill a glass of water, and you're going to be like, Daniel! And he's just going to blow up on Daniel because all those little things have been building up and it's going to explode. So it's a daily practice for me. It's a daily practice to share resentments with my brother, who I spend a lot of time around with, the people I spend the most time around with.
I say let the little firecrackers out so you don't have to deal with a big bomb later. I actually stole that from Burzon. Thank you, Burzon.
Now, is there anything that you have to share resentment with me about?
Well, here's what comes up.
Because before you start, I want you to share it to me, just as if the camera wasn't here.
Yeah. Well, as irrational as I judge this to be, it's part of me has a resentment towards you that you don't show affection to Zephyr. For example, you know, when Zephyr maybe walks or lays down on a blanket that you would be using to sleep on, it's kind of like your first reaction is, get that dirty dog off my blanket. And, you know, there's a part of me that looks at that, kind of resent Timothy about that.
Yeah, I can see that. I know Zephyr is very important to you. And sometimes I wonder if I'm doing that just to make you mad a little bit. And I really appreciate you bringing my awareness to that, JP. Thanks for sharing your resentment with me.
You're welcome. I appreciate you hearing.
Yeah, I would say that's a more organic expression of reacting to JP's resentment. But I would definitely recommend RUVA for anyone watching. And that acronym's helped me. And it might help you, like, make sure you're being present with yourself and the other person. But I really liked how you clarified that was irrational. Emotions, there's a difference between your emotions and your logic for a reason. Your emotions are not necessarily logical. And it's so hard for sometimes a logical mind to wrap itself around that.
Yeah.
That's one of our exercises. We share the most ridiculous resentments we can at our retreats just to overcompensate for all the times we've hid things because they weren't rational.
Yeah, it's the fundamental nature of emotions, just piggybacking on what you said, Daniel, is emotions work emotionally, not rationally. And I would also dare say it's not logical to always be logical. Yet our logical faculties, they want to feel like they're in control. So they look at this beautiful creation of life, and it says, let's narrow the spectrum. Let's only do this dance with this miracle called life that has logical footsteps. So I think that takes the 360-degree sphere of life and eliminates about 359 degrees of it. To me, it limits it. I love logic. And I also love not loving logic. So I love your idea about emotions are not always logical.
Yeah, and that's why I love ridiculous resentments. The more ridiculous for me, the better, because then it's like, oh, yeah. Wow, it really helps me distinguish that I'm a person that has a lot of stuff going on. That I'm not just this robot carrying a brain around. That I'm much more than a robot carrying a brain around. They also have a heart. They also have these emotions I can't really explain with words, I don't think. Properly, anyways. That I feel that, man, there's just so much stuff going on. You've got a spirit.
We can go in the whole aspect of the spiritual, the emotional, the physical, the logical. And to think that you're just one of those, or you're just one part of one of those, it's might not be the highest service to yourself.
Yeah. A funny thing about emotions, and keep in mind I'm biased. I earn my living doing emotional human coaching with clients, so guy in the middle is pretty biased here, folks, with that disclaimer said. We've been talking about your emotions, your feelings, sharing them with people, and incredibly healing. However, I would also add to that, talking about emotions is not a replacement for feeling our emotions. I believe we need to feel our emotions and then talk about them so that the intensity of the emotion can be more potentiated, so we can connect with more of what's there, rather than using talking about them, sharing, as a convenient tool that looks healing and looks enriching, yet in fact the talking is used as a tool to deflect from us feeling our emotions.
Mm.
The path we take to find ourselves can eventually become the path we lose ourselves on.
I've probably been found guilty of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I actually have an example of that recently. My girlfriend recently broke up with me. And, you know, I am very proud of how I handled that. I actually took the whole day, the following day, to try to amplify the sensations that I was experiencing as much as possible. And I meditate on that. I just was like, really reliving that and how I felt about that. And I was trying to feel as much as I possibly could. Feel the sadness, and I did. Boy, did I feel that sadness. And I prayed about it, and I felt it, and I prayed about it, and I felt it. And then the days following, I was amazed at how at peace I felt.
Yeah.
Like if you would have told me that she was going to break up with me, I would imagine that I would have been, like, out of the game for weeks, maybe months. So that's just a personal testament to it. Does that sound kind of congruent?
Yeah, it's very interesting. So to me, it sounds like you gave yourself a cleanse. You know, an intense day of, I am not only going to feel these emotions, I'm going to swim in them. I'm going to submerge myself in them for the purpose of kind of like how you would do a liver cleanse, get rid of a lot of toxins. So there's a lot of people who would take that volume of emotional charge you had. And they might take 50 years to gradually, bit by bit, detoxify that. But that means for 50 years, they're going to have a certain amount of weight that's influencing their life. And I would also say, to the degree that they're not just allowing the emotions to run their natural course, their life becomes dictated, shaped out of avoiding their emotions. So I think that's very beneficial what you've done. And I mean, realistically, sometimes our emotions are so intense. So many of my emotions, and I'm not going to be like Timothy, just take a full day to feel them. I'm going to take a few minutes here and there. And, you know, if I'm really challenged, if I say, well, I don't feel like I'm strong enough to handle this, I'm going to do what I can for now and realize there's more to come back later. And anytime we have your C word, courage, to really submerge and cleanse, I think that's pretty cool.
You sound like you Ruba'd all over yourself.
Ruba'd, yeah. And I, don't get me wrong, it wasn't just a day. You know, it came and flared up again. Every once in a while, I just feel like intense sadness in my heart. Mm-hmm. And it was that moment when I was like, okay, I'm feeling this. I need to take like 15, 20 minutes and really amplify these feelings. Like really, really feel it.
Because we all know when you have a feeling and you really feel that feeling, it can come and go. However, the other side of that is what you resist has a potential to persist.
Mm-hmm.
And the crazy part about that is that sometimes, you know how we said, not only do we have emotions, but we have a physical body. Sometimes I think those persistence of emotions can manifest into things in our body that are not always the most desirable things in our body.
Yeah.
Y'all think any truth to that?
Yes, sir.
Absolutely. In fact, on that note, if you imagine you were watching a scary movie, you know, you've got Freddy Krueger, he's hiding behind a corner about to chop someone's head off. You know, when you can see the lady moving towards that corner and she doesn't know Freddy's there and you know what's going to happen to her, you just feel what you're doing in your body. You're probably going to be holding your breath to a degree. You're probably going to be tense. So that's us strangulating our fear response right then and there, because who has the presence of mind in the movie to say, wow, I'm really scared right now. Let's get vulnerable with what I'm afraid Freddy's going to do. But yeah, that tension in the body, and that changes, that has the potential to change our whole pH balance. Typically, the more emotionally tense we are, the more physically tense we get, more physically tense we are over a long period of time, we have more lactic acid in our systems, which changes us to become more acidic, which predisposes us to be living in an anaerobic environment. Acid always goes together with anaerobic, which is a perfect breeding ground for cancer. That's why a lot of naturally minded cancer treatments would have forgiveness and getting your anger out. Not driving your anger deeper so you're less aware of it, but getting your anger out. What is the root cause? That may have happened 30 years ago, but what's the root cause that's created all this tension, that's created all these symptoms, that's maybe even created the symptom of a pretty serious disease?
Well, on the topic of authenticity, I don't know about you guys, but I'm feeling like I want to wrap this video out.
Wow, we're on the same page. I was gonna think of a transition too that we could go on for days.
Yeah.
This is where, I mean, I think we're all passionate about this,
we
and
are.
Hopefully you are as well. I mean, who's not passionate about connecting to something much bigger through us by being a more whole being? If you're not, hopefully this may have helped switch your mind. And yeah, how did they find you, Jay Pizzle, if this is the first time?
Yeah, well, I appreciate you throwing that plug. Feel free to subscribe to my YouTube channel, AwakenWithJP, youtube.com/AwakenWithJP. I put new videos out every week, sometimes twice a week, so I'd love to dance with you in my little playground. And thank you, Daniel and Timothy and the ghost of Nathaniel, for having me on the RawBrahs channel. I love playing with my friends.
Yeah, thank you. And I know that you're, when you upload a video, you're one of the very few people that I make sure to watch that video, because I really do enjoy your videos. So if you like me, then maybe you should do what I like to do and watch those videos. And in case, just based on listening to other people's podcasts and watching other people's videos, it seems like what you're supposed to do to end these is, if you're listening to a podcast, check out the video on our YouTube channel and comment. Let us know what you're thinking so we know what you're thinking. Share what you don't want to share about the video or the podcast. Rate it. Do all those things that if you believe in this message to help us get that message out there. Because although I might have jealousy or insecurity, maybe sometimes I wonder, am I in JP's shadow? Or maybe Timothy wonders he's in my shadow. That we still, that might, I believe that's our mind. And a part of my mind that I'm not necessarily want to give power to, so I go to my heart and realize that there's something much bigger than my jealousy or insecurity. There might be a much higher vibrational frequency, thank you, Teal, that might be loving their message, regardless of my insecurity, because I do love it. I love what these guys are saying, and I think we all feel that way, and we want to support each other. So if you feel that way, if you feel like you want other people to tap into this type of communication or authenticity, then do your part. And it's pretty simple. Social media, thank you, Mark Zuckerberg, and whoever else came with these nifty ideas where we can just make any idea go viral with a click of the button.
Before you start thinking, Mark Zuckerberg, I got homework for you is, you're going to be in a conversation soon. Maybe you're in a group conversation. Something's going to come up for you that would make you feel uncomfortable sharing. My homework for you is to share it and just see what happens. See what happens with your group of friends with the context. Peace in.
See you guys.